overcame the pain and all the hardships. We focus on our game and kept the targets. They try to take our brain and keep our raw gifts, but we still remain and now we bullshit. Flawless, you know how it go. Black power looking good and we let it show. We stack by the hour, yeah, and we let it grow. These crackers not doing nothing, we let them know. Nothing you can do gonna change us. We always gonna be around, we gonna bang war. We never gonna simmer down, you can't tame us. No religion, no criticism can chain us. Black is all you hear when I'm talking. I'm repping for the light to the dark skin. RBG stepping when I walk in. Crackers really mad cause I'm flossing. Black is all you see around me. I put my hands in these hearts in the streets, yeah, they lean on me.
Same script, hopping off the same shit ever since they dropped me off the slave ship.
Black is all you see around me. I put my hands in these hearts in these streets, yeah, they lean on me.
Rocking with the same script, hopping off the same shit ever since they dropped me off the slave ship.
Watch the step out, a black king. My fist in the air while I'm rapping. RBG, where you see my fashion? My fame is all here, no lacking. You see the vision, it's all clear. Black power living here with no fear. We dig the prisons, we drop the tears. Now we focus on this our peers. RBG, yeah, on the pop out. A cracker go to sleep, that's a knockout. What you want to eat, go and rock out. Black everything, it's a lockout. The camera's on now, go and take a flick. The pressure been on, can't take a hit. Ever since they dropped me off the slave ship, I've been on the same shit. Black is all you see around me. I put my hands in these hearts in these streets, yeah, they ain't on me.
Rockin' with the same script, hopping off the same shit ever since they dropped me off the spaceship.
Black is all you see around me. I put my hands in these hearts in these streets, yeah, they ain't on me.
Rockin' with the same script, hopping off the same shit ever since they dropped me off the slave ship.
You think you be going like this? Hey, that's it. Come on, Dad. Show me.
Show
him
Good evening, good evening, good evening, family. Welcome to another edition of Thorough Black Talk with your sister Keisha, your brother Tad, and your brother Ashe SJ. We'll be joining us shortly, along with our weekly correspondents, Sister Marcia and Brother Blacksmith, coming in with the 1-2 punch, giving us that real. Can't wait for them to get on tonight. We got a lot to discuss, boy. I'm telling you, we giving it to you real on Thorough Black Talk. So we'd like to thank each and every one of you for taking your time to join us on the Brooklyn Bridge to come and join us how we do it every Thursday. I see my brother Tag getting ready on the back end. I see we got some of our guests trying to get in on the back end. They getting ready. You had the New York City Marathon that took place this past weekend, so we're going to discuss that, some history behind that, black history actually behind that. We got to discuss it. Also, you know, we had some arrests that took place in New York City of the Gambino crime family, allegedly trying to take over the, you know, disposal industry, the garbage disposal industry. But notice that the police didn't have to pull out their guns and shoot none of them in the back or anything like that, even though they are known criminals. Been on the FBI watch for quite some time. So we'll discuss that along with, you know, we're coming up on the Black family holiday season. You know, don't let these people keep you away from your family. You understand? We're coming up on the season, so we're going to discuss the history of some Black dishes, some soul food dishes that some of us are used to, and, you know, spark up some memories of families with your parents and grandparents, aunts and uncles and cousins. We're going to get into all of that tonight. And also, we're going to discuss the excellence, Black excellent business, and their responsibility in our fight for reparations. So we get into all of that tonight. And also we're going to have some of our community activists, SWAP sisters, community workers, I should say, come on and join us tonight and let you know about a coat drive we have coming up this Sunday at Therapy Wine Bar. We are giving back to our people in need. You know, you see the government giving out millions and billions to everybody except us. We ain't getting no bread, no bread. So we got to help each other out. So we'll talk about the coat drive in a minute, family. But let me get my brother Tad in here. Give me 1 second. Are you ready, brother Tad? Give me the thumbs up. Brother Tad, how you feeling? What's good?
Life is good. Life is good. Unless the judge give it to you. How you feeling, Sister Keisha?
Great, great, great. I'm feeling great. You know, I'm getting better. You know, my health is getting better. The more I exercise, you know, I'm still on this 80% fruit diet lifestyle change, I should say.
Okay, you
know,
okay.
My eating habits is, you know, raw fruits. So 80%, 85% pretty much. That's has been my lifestyle for the past year now. Actually, this Thanksgiving Eve will make it a full year that I have been on this journey. So, and it helps me. It helps me. But tonight, Brother Tad, we're going to talk about some good food tonight.
Yeah, don't forget your proteins, though. You definitely need your proteins to fuel the muscles. You know, keep the muscles activated. Keep up the strength. You don't want to lose no strength. Protein is very important. But yeah, fruit, like, you can't get fat on fruit. You can get full, but you can't get fat. So fruit is always a definite, especially early in the morning. So salute to you. I'm getting back on it, sis. I'm getting back on it, you know. Speaking of the marathon, I got bit with the bug. I said, I miss it. So I may start training again for 2025, you know, get back in there, spend all next year just training, getting back into it, bulletproofing my body, you know, because I think that's the most important part. You got to change the mindset, and then you got to get your body primed, not just for the actual run, but afterwards, because your body could break down, collapse, all kind of foolishness. I've seen people hit what's called a proverbial wall, where you run and your body just gives out and you collapse. You don't even feel it. It just happens. From what I hear, I never hit the wall, thank goodness. But again, I train hard. You know, I train real hard.
That's what's up, Brother Tad. I know you got to get back out there. I miss seeing you out there. Get you out there. Get back in the grind. But you're right about proteins. You know, like I said, 85% of my diet is raw for fruits. And it's also a great healing mechanism, right? I've been able to keep from having to take medications for high blood pressure or anything else. And you know, like I said, I'm seeing some differences in, see, my mom was deceased at the age of 51. So I have outlived her, right? And making these changes in my lifestyle, I have to, right? To continue for the next generation. So, you know, it takes some time to get used to. You know, don't get out there and rush yourself into it and start panicking and bugging out, searching high and low for fried chicken. You know,
ease yourself. Still eat my fried chicken now.
Oh, of course. Of course, of course. We're going to get into all that. Actually, we're going to talk about some history on fried chicken tonight, Brother Tad. So, you know, it's very important that we maintain our cultural ways because, you know, the fights that we are facing are cultural wars. And we have to remember these traditions, where they come from, and we have to carry them out, carry them on, whether we want to believe in them or not. You know, fact beats a belief any day.
But now, sis, when you say cultural war, break it down for those who may not be familiar with that term.
Well, what? Let me just start by saying that the Black man and woman is the blueprint for family, the blueprint for society. We are the backbone of moral compass for the world. That being the framework of what I mean, this cultural war, they are coming for that belief system. And although we have different tribal customs, no matter where we come from around the globe, one thing that connects us all is the very basics that I just laid out. And so that is why you see entities like the United States and Europe trying to force Africa to accept alternative lifestyles as their own. But, you know, they are pushing back and saying, no, these are not our norms. They are your norms. And you keep that over there. But Ted, as you said many times, you know, our people are falling victim to this propaganda assault, twisting the culture, dictating what the culture is. And they are grasping onto it, forgetting what grandma and grandpa taught you, forgetting what your mother and father taught you. We're forgetting all of these things. So, you know, this is the war that we're in. This is why you see them pushing people like a Sexy Red as opposed to a Meeko Marx or whoever. You know, this is crazy. They'll push a Yachty over or Darius Rucker. So this is what we're dealing with here. These people have possession of our magic, as Brother Black Dot said. And that magic is the thread that binds us all. Speaking of that, I'm going to be doing a lecture next week, Wednesday, at the BK William Mackey History Club on the history of African-American music. Yeah. So it's going to be fire. It's going to be a lot of fun. I see my brother Black in the background. We're going to get Brother Black in here. And then I see our guests. So we're going to get them in here so we can get started on our program. Brother Black, what's good? How you doing?
Peace, y'all. Peace. Glad to be here. We got a lot to talk about. I'm ready to go. So I'm going to give back to
Brother Black. All right. We talking about fried chicken and big macaroni tonight. All right. Just for clarity, brother.
You forgot about the Callaloo.
The Callaloo. Nah, I'm American. We eat collard greens.
I'm a black American. Even that, you know. In the Caribbean, they eat callaloo. Here we have collard greens. So, listen, they're very similar in their texture. They're very similar in their look. So, again, these are things that bind us all together. So we got to remember to hold on to these things in this cultural war that's trying to divide all of us.
Yes, ma'am.
So let me give some shout-outs real quick, and we'll get our guest in here. Donna on the check-in. What's up? Good evening to you all the way from Birmingham, Alabama. Birmingham, as you know, the great Reverend used to say, Birmingham.
I hope she was on the riverboat.
I hope so, too.
I got my phone this year. Brother
I got a whole bunch downstairs. We can get busy.
Hey, all them people got slaps on the wrist. The white people that attacked the black man, slaps on the wrist. They ain't getting no gangster time. None of that.
Were we really expecting it, though? I think those ass whoopings was enough. That's all we needed to see, you know. And, of course, salute to the brother who swam across the water. Said, we ain't going to wait for this boat to dock.
That's sea murder.
But real quick, right, speaking on that, and then I'm going to step off my soapbox. I think that was very important because a lot of times they always – show images of us being docile and peaceful, and seldom do they show us resistant. Though those of us who study our history and our culture know that we have a legacy of resistance. We come, Thorough Black Talk, come in the spirit of resistance, in the spirit of Nat Turner, Gabriel Prosser, Denmark Vesey, Harriet Tubman, and the likes, Nanny of the Maroons, Sojourner Truth, Ida B. Wells, those who stood in the face of what was the status quo. And said, nah, we're not going for this. Sure enough, as I asked Sister Keisha about the cultural wars, we want people to understand that our way of life, the way that we see what a family is, man, woman, and child, this is our culture. This is our cultural norm. This is our mores, our folklore. These are the things that makes us us, the things our parents taught us, things we teach our children. But here you got a group of people that are not from our community, that don't hold the same family values, the same social values, and they're trying to enforce it on us. They're changing the language on us. So when Sister Keisha brought up culture wars, these are the things that I want our audience to get familiar with who may not be familiar with it. Because a lot of times we talk about racism, we just keep thinking of images of water hoses and dogs barking, people swinging from trees, and people being in chains. Let me slow down a little bit. It has changed. Superficially, it has changed, but fundamentally, it's the same. People exercising their dominance over another group of people. And this is time with on a riverboat. We resisted. We resisted that day. Them people only got slaps on the wrist, but a couple of them got some chairs upside their head, which is very important. So now they create a new social norm for Black folks. When that hat go up in the air, we know it's time to spring into action. Somebody throw a hat in the air, you grab a folding chair.
Hey, just throw yours up one time, man, like Onyx.
You know what I'm saying? But I say now, the war is psychological. The culture war is psychological, where they have access to our children and they indoctrinate our children with foolishness, telling them that a little boy can be a princess and a little girl can be a grown man. And we know these things are not biologically true. However, like I always say, the Black struggle is different than any other struggle in the history of the world, because our struggle is to put things back in its natural order. When we were stolen from Africa, when we were forced to work the fields, when we were moved from our ancestral land, all that was against who we are naturally. There's certain foods we eat because of the accessibility to it. So it's a diet we need. It's the same as if you take a polar bear and put him into a forest, and you take a grizzly bear and put him in the Antarctic. Both of them are bears, but they won't survive because that's not their natural habitat. And that is what's been done to us as Africans. We were pulled from our natural habitat and dispersed all over places that wasn't naturally for us. We didn't have the opportunity to adjust and adapt like our ancestors who may have settled on that land prior to our kidnapping. So we become strangers in foreign lands, and it's hard for us to operate. And as Sister Keisha said, they'll give us a Sukiana, they'll give us a Sexy Red and Nicki Minaj and all of these people, thumbing their noses in the face of a Whitney Houston, of so many beautiful Black women who've come before today's entertainers, you know, Lady Day and the likes, you know. We have to get back to who we are naturally, because what's happening right now ain't it. So here on Thorough Black Talk, we're the vanguard for these culture wars. We come in the spirit of a Dr. Khaled, a Dr. Clark, a Dr. Ben, a Dr. Isha Kamusa Barashango. We come in the spirit of Nanny of the Maroons, Queen Mother Moore, and the likes. We are the resistance. And I think it's very important that people understand what's happening, because our children are being attacked. They're not worried about us as adults anymore. They're going after our children. And unfortunately, they gained a little ground on us. But I'm going to step off my soapbox. I want to get into this fried chicken and baked macaroni.
I bet you do.
I'm always a fat boy at heart.
I hear you, Brother Tad. I hear you. Let me give some shout-out. Shout-out to Sister Joyce and Brother Monty on the check-in. Aunt Maria, Uncle Jesse, what's good with you, Peasy? What's happening? Brother Peace, my brother from another mother. BK's finest in the building. You got Sister Rep Farnessa, a BB Fahodier to you. A BB Fahodier you got ripped off. Stair Excellence, hello to you. Anasu, peace, 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 peace. Brother Kev, my cackalacky brother. Geechee family in the building. And the Dr. Filet on the check-in. MWM, we just passed their anniversary the end of last month. You know, in the last few episodes, we were talking about women. You know, we talked about Jada Pinkett Smith. We talked about Sister Soulja. We talked about Winnie Mandela. Now, I want you to think about what happened to these women in their lives. And you can add Betty Shabazz to that as well. later on in their lives. Tragic things have happened. But you should know that the women that I just named, and you know, they were headliners at the Million Woman March. After that, things went sideways for all of them. All of them. All of them. You know, had the pleasure because we were stationed, my cousin and I and our friend, where we were, I was close to the stage. So when they came off to use the restroom or whatever, we had the pleasure of speaking with all of them. So I just want you to remember that, you know, as we move through life, that when you take a stand for something real serious, watch how the lives of those who put it all on the line end up. You can look at your greatest freedom fighters, same thing. We are dealing with a serious system, and we have to understand that it's serious business. So, you know, in that, we have to be steadfast in our fight, in our liberation. And also remember that we got to reach out and help each other. Always remember that. My mother used to always tell me, you know, my mother was a beacon for the community. No lie. You know, whatever somebody need, if she had it, you had it. Anybody. So that was bestowed upon us in our family. You understand? We watched her. So being involved in our community, it's nothing for us. It's nothing for us. So, you know, many years ago, one of my family members founded an organization for Black women, knowing that we as women, we have to have spaces that are safe for us to discuss things, to be women. But in all of that, you know, be beacons of light in our community. You know, all of us come from different walks of life. All of us connected to her in some way or another. And so she founded this organization, Sisterhood with a Purpose. And, you know, ever since then, we've been rocking and rolling, doing what we have to do, not just for the community, but as women growing in business. Some of us have founded our own businesses and become, you know, we about that life, for real, for real. So we're going to have Tashiba come in here and talk about the coat drive we have coming up this Sunday at Therapy Wine Bar. Shout out to Therapy Wine Bar for hosting us and doing that. So, Tashiba, good to see you. What it is,
people. Brother Ted, check it out, hey, check it out.
Tashiba, that's right. We rock our crown with respect over here.
That's right.
You see that? You see the difference between Brooklyn and the Bronx?
Yes.
You see that?
Hey, where's the hat from?
Definitely New not York.
We're going to have to mute his mic.
Specifically in New York. Come on, cut it out.
There he go.
New York City, specifically.
There he go. Wait till Marcia get in here. Here he go with the shenanigans. We helping y'all out. We giving light to the Bronx. Stop playing. But Tashiba, all jokes aside, we got this fundraiser coming up this weekend, this Sunday.
Yes.
To give back to the community, we have a coat drive that we do every year to give back to people in need in homeless shelters, family homeless shelters. So family, we taking them all. Men, women, and children. We can take all gently used coats. Or you can send us, you know, send Sister Keisha a Cash App, and I'll purchase the coat if you can't, you know, be there in person and you want to contribute. So Tashiba, give us the 411. What's good?
So I'm super excited that it's finally going to happen. Unfortunately, we couldn't do it last week due to the marathon. But like Keisha said, it's something that we do every year. We try to give back to the community. You know, just clean out your closet. It's funny because cleaning out my closet, I found like 3 coats that I even wear. And I'm like, why do I keep these coats? And I was kind of holding on to them. But I was like, you know what? Someone could use it. So let me part ways with this coat. So I went through my closet, went through my son's closet, and we found some coats, and we're going to donate the coats, and we're going to look forward to everyone coming out and supporting this event. It's at Therapy Wine Bar this Sunday from 12 to 4. If you donate a coat, you'll get a complimentary glass of wine. And you'll also receive a cupcake from Yolanda Sweets. So okay. I'm excited. I'm excited about the fellowship, just meeting, you know, new people, and just, you know, hanging out and obviously doing what we do with a purpose.
That's what I'm talking about. So shout out to the Swap Sisters watching on the back end. Some of them couldn't make it. They working, you know, busy ladies. We don't play no games over here. So before we let you go, because, you know, we shout out, you know, institutions over here. So right now, you and Sister Tower have formed an institution. Whether you want to see it that way or not, that's what it is. You got to think big and talk big and act big, and that's what it will be. So let's tell the people about Elite Brooklyn Jumpers.
Absolutely. So my partner, Tower, and I decided to bring Double Dutch back to the community. Double Dutch is something that we grew up on. Like, we've been jumping Double Dutch since, I know I've been jumping since I was like 11. Really took it serious when I was like, you know, 14. When I would see the girls in my community jumping, I'm like, I want to be like them. I want to go outside. I want to do that. And right after the pandemic, I was, you know, kind of like talking to her, and I'm like, look, let's go jump Double Dutch. Let's just go outside and have fun. And she was like, all right, let's do it. So we decided to pull up in front of Grand Army Plaza, and we just started jumping. And the love that we received from the community was unbelievable. I mean, folks from everywhere just kind of like walking through the park, like, hey, wait a minute, what's going on here? And, oh, I never knew how to do it. And we was like, look, just give us a minute, and we'll teach you how to jump Double Dutch. And sure enough, anyone that jumped with us, we could teach you how to jump in a Brooklyn minute.
And I had to go out there and show them how to jump.
Yes, you did, Brother Tad. You did join us one day. You did. Yes, you did on the team. That was like, come on. And he did it. He was so happy.
Yeah. They ain't know I knew how to jump, sis.
So it's awesome.
I had to show my skills a little bit.
Exactly. You know,
so Brooklyn style.
It's definitely a pleasure bringing Double Dutch back, Street Double Dutch, back to the community. We've been blessed. Like that one, this was 2001, so we started getting gigs. Like, people would start booking us for like birthday parties, block parties. We've done after school, we've done PAL over the summer. So it's just so many blessings that came from this opportunity, just jumping Double Dutch, just doing something that we love to do, which is jump Double Dutch. Unfortunately, I now can't jump because I have a bulging disc from jumping Double Dutch, so I have to chill for a little while. But I still teach.
Why don't you take it to the gym?
So I'm doing like I go to the stretch lounge. I'm in physical therapy. I do need to get to like yoga or something like that, because it's horrible.
Or Tai Chi.
So, yeah, I need something. I need something to really be consistent with working out wise. Because I have like sciatica now. So sciatica goes down my leg, and that's the problem, right? Because once you start moving and you get that pain, you just want to sit down.
I got you, Sister Tashima. Don't worry about it.
You got me, Brother Tad?
You know I got you. Oh, I got you like a bad cold. Don't even worry about it.
Thank you.
The shenanigans. Here we go.
That's my sister. I got to hold her down.
You got to. It's family. You got to, or else I'll tell.
Hey, we're gonna take it back to the 80s, and we're gonna be stealing coats and bringing them to you. So we're gonna get drunk that night.
Yes, do steal some coats. That's right. Steal all the coats and bring
them Bronx people, boys.
And the recipients of the coats will go to WIN, which is Women in Need Shelter in Brooklyn. It's a woman in need, but it is a family shelter. So if you have men coats, women coats, kids coats, feel free to, you know, stop by and drop off a coat.
Yes, indeed, family. So again, we hope to see you this Sunday, 12 to 4 p.m. at Therapy Wine Bar 2.0 in Brooklyn. Come out, bring a coat, clean them closets out, stop hoarding.
Exactly.
Hello, Sister Keisha. Wine and cupcakes, right?
Wine and cupcakes.
And cupcakes.
And it's on 260 Malcolm X Boulevard. So it's right on the corner of Malcolm X and Halsey.
Okay.
And it's a Black-owned establishment. So you definitely should come out and support.
Thank you. And that's another thing. Team Swap definitely supports Black-owned businesses. And oftentimes when we do our events, we are in collaboration with other Black-owned businesses. Absolutely. That's how we move around here. You have to network and you have to get it out and let people know what you're doing. So we definitely appreciate Team Swap and all the work that you do. Ladies, I will see you all on Sunday. Y'all have a good rest of the week. Catch you in the chat in the morning.
Thank Sister you, guys.
Marcia, you got any questions before we let her go?
Oh, yeah. Do you guys have any questions? Hopefully in the spring, I'll see most of you guys jumping double dutch with us in front of Grand Army Plaza.
And we listen, I record. My job is to record, take pictures. I ride bikes. I don't jump.
You could check us out on Instagram at Elite, ELITEBKLYN Jumpers.
Can I make a suggestion?
Go for it.
You want to use the double dutch bus for your theme song?
It's so funny, right? Because we use that sometimes. Like we're having an event and someone asks us what we want to play, we'll say that song or what's those little boys, crisscross, jump, jump.
Jump, jump. Yeah, that's a good song. What about Jump Around by House of Pain?
Ah, I didn't think about that one. Yeah. So if you know of any businesses or, you know, oh, thank you, Keisha, that's looking for us. I actually hate that picture because that's when I broke my toe. Right there.
That very moment.
That very moment, yes. So high, I touch the clouds. Whoa, oh, 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 oh. I stretch my hands up to the sky. We dance with monsters through the night. Whoa, oh, 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 oh. Whoa, oh, 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 oh. I'm never gonna look back. Whoa.
I ain't playing, I'm on a mission. I don't see no competition. Waiting my turn and I play my position. Sat in the room, I ain't talk, I didn't listen. I ain't have no motion, no motion went far.
Check them out. Follow them on the gram. Elite, yeah, Brooklyn definitely. Jumpers.
Anytime somebody's saying some kind of event, I'm looking for something. And Double Dutch and hip hop go hand in hand.
Yeah,
so,
sure. That's a fact.
Yeah, so if you need to plug us in, feel free. Shoot me a text, email, hit me on Instagram, and we'll follow up.
I wonder where hip hop from.
Brooklyn, come on, man. Hey, you sister, heard of Grandmaster Flowers. Stop it.
Hey, Sister Tashima, friend me on Facebook.
I think I need to call Brother Peace because we're going to have to squash this hip hop from the Bronx, man. We're going to have to squash it once and for all. Shout out to the legendary DJ Lenz. Always, always, always. Didn't mean to cut your wisdom, Brother Black Eye.
No, I was just telling Sister Tashima, friend me on Facebook as Elias Flavius. Everybody here is on my page except Marcia. So,
right. Yeah. I don't have Facebook. Are you on Instagram?
Oh, wow.
I don't.
No. Must be from Brooklyn.
It's the Bronx.
Must be a Brooklyn thing.
Must be a Brooklyn thing. Yeah.
Thank you.
I was trying to minimize my social media interaction.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay.
I was like, I just need one, and Instagram seems like it's doing what it needs
okay,
to do.
Okay. I'm on there. I look for you.
Thank you.
Here you go. Aunt Marie says she'll see us on Sunday. She'll see us.
Oh, great. Thank you, cuz.
Blacksmith, just send them coats in, man. Don't even look good. 260 Malcolm X Boulevard, the corner of Halsey.
I'm going to send.
A glass of wine and a cupcake.
Hey, I'm going to send Tad a coat of paint and put BX on his face.
Lord have mercy. You see the shenanigans? You see what I got to deal with, Tashima?
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. Pray for me, cuz. Pray for me. I'll see you on Sunday.
All right, guys. Thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
Yes,
it's always good to see Sister Tashima.
Hello, Madame Bois.
Yes. And you know, that's my family for real, just so y'all know. It's my family for real.
Yes.
Mother's siblings. So, anyway, Sister Marcia, good to see you. What's good?
Peace, family. Good to see y'all.
We had the marathon this past Sunday, but I wanted to highlight a little bit of Black history. with the New York City Marathon. You know, now they have this five borough run, right? All five boroughs now. But where did all that come from? Here we go.
The course of the New York City Marathon, the largest in the world, the route that it is, a lot of it has to do with this man, Ted Corbett. Corbett was the first Black man to compete in the Olympic Marathon for the U.S. in 1952. In 1958, he became the first president of the Roadrunners, which hosts the New York City Marathon. And it was Corbett who measured the very first route right here in Central Park in 1970. 127 participants logged their 26.2 miles by going once around the reservoir and four times around the park. 6 years later, Corbett proposed the five borough race that still exists today. Runners finished the marathon on the same stretch, now known as Ted Corbett Loop. Since the start, the marathon has been open to everyone, regardless of race, gender, or ability. Visit our new exhibition, Running for Civil Rights, to learn more about how Corbett and others paved the way for some 48,000 runners to race through the streets of New York City every year. Why is...
There you have it. There you have it. Historical background of where that route came from, how it started. And I watched many a news broadcast about the marathon last Sunday. Every news outlet had it on. Nobody talked about Mr. Ted.
My medals.
Just look at Brother Ted. Shots fired again. Look, Brother Black, he dipped out. He dipped out once you pulled out the medals, Ted. He dipped out.
I'm trying to find my Ted Corbett medal. Just, you know.
Shout out to Brother Ted.
I'll be back out there.
We play no games over here. It's real, no. Family. Don't play no games over here. Sister Marcia, what you think about that historical piece?
New knowledge. And every day is something new to learn. I never knew about Mr. Corbin and his spectacular works. And it is for us to edify the spectacular works that people do in our community. Because if we're waiting for someone else to talk about us, it's not going to happen. Absolutely not.
Facts, facts, facts. I loved it. You know, it's my first time finding out about it, actually. I didn't even know. But because I don't mess with the Bronx. But anyway.
Well, Sister Keisha, I'm about to tell you, I literally run New York.
Biden.
Including the Bronx.
Y'all notice I'm the only one representing Brooklyn tonight, right? Y'all notice that, right? All right.
We got a bunch of transplants in Brooklyn. It's okay. We're used to it by now. Once we gave the world Biggie, everybody from Brooklyn. Like all of a sudden,
the freeloaders. Here we go. Here go the freeloaders. But you know, we got to let them go ahead.
Just like the pilgrims.
I got something for you, Brother Black. Hold on. Here we go. Check out some history of the Bronx and why you have such a large.
Like my houses is in Manhattan.
But excuse me, uptown. Thanks for the correction. Now you want to know why there's such a large Latino population in that area. Here's a little history and a little background. Here we go.
Before the Dyckman houses, there once stood a short-lived sports stadium that played a pivotal role in Negro League baseball history. The Dyckman Oval, built in 1915, was a sports venue in Inwood, spanning from Academy Street to 204th Street and Nagel Avenue to 10th Avenue. This 4,500-seat multi-sport stadium was used for baseball as well as football, boxing, cricket, speed skating, and soccer. Even Babe Ruth himself played an exhibition match here in 1935 after his retirement as a New York Yankee. Left on life support during the Great Depression, the Oval was reborn in 1935 when the stadium was leased from the city by Cuban entrepreneur Alejandro Pompez. Pompez expanded seating to 10,000 and installed floodlights to host games at night, several years before other New York Major League teams did. The Oval, often called Harlem's Own, became one of the homes for Negro League baseball. Like Pompey's New York Cubans, comprised of Cuban, African-American, Mexican, Puerto Rican, and Dominican players.
Pompez was a criminal in the eyes of the police and a crown prince in the eyes of Harlemites. From his cigar store, the soft-spoken Cuban ran a numbers bank, a lottery that filled his pockets to the tune of $8,000 a day, which he used to fund his Negro League baseball team, the New York Cubans.
Pompez, along with several owners of the Negro National League, were numbers bankers. He was one of New York's leading numbers bankers during the 1920s. Before the dike.
So you see, you know, a little history, a little background of, you know, our people in that area, how they settled in that area, right? You have to remember that also this gentleman had his bouts with Dutch Schultz as well, just like, you know, Stephanie Sinclair had serious bouts with Dutch Schultz. So if you can, you know, in your spare time, read a little up a little bit more history on that gentleman, and you'll be surprised at what you find out. Your thoughts, Brother Black?
Thank you for that history, Keisha.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. I wanted to talk about, because, you know, we're moving across the globe, this fight to get the yoke of oppression off of our backs. You have people in various African countries, various South American and Caribbean countries who are fighting back, if you will, and have had enough, especially with this influx of migrants that are coming into these cities. And as that Dr. Claude Anderson once said, you know, whether you want to understand it or not, you're being pushed to the back. And, you know, these people, folks are here to replace you, to replace you. So some sisters in, well, not just sisters, but brothers as well, formed a committee to stay on the necks of local politicians in the city of Chicago, and pleading their own cause, not allowing others to plead their cause. And they are giving them the hammer 1-2. What I wish is that you had committees like this in every major city around the United States, because we have to fight as one globally against this oppressor, because the oppressor fights globally against you. So we, you know, and I'm also going to play a clip of Sister Marcia saying the very exact same things that these sisters from Chicago are saying a couple of shows ago. So let's hear this, and shout out to Phil Scott podcast for posting this. Here we go. Let's listen to these ladies.
That there needs to be a federal audit against the company that we have contracted out to take care of the migrants. We have nurses that are being paid $64,000 a month. We have security officers that are being paid as much as $24,000 a month. We have home health care workers that are being paid up to $17,000 a month. You don't think that Chicagoans could have benefited from that? We have citizens in this city that have been on the waiting list for affordable housing for years, and migrants have been bumped in front of them. We have people who have been given up to $9,000 a month for housing assistance. That amount of money can be life-changing for some families here in the city of Chicago. We are not anti-migrant. We do sympathize with them. But what I am is I am pro-Black. I am for my people who have been mistreated, who have been marginalized, who have been disrespected. And it is disrespectful for people to expect us to give up our parks and our schools and places in our community for others. We're not saying that there's not room here, but what we are saying is that we are not going to step aside for you to accommodate them when you have continued to leave us out of the equation. So I'm not just talking to Brandon Johnson right now. I'm talking to Governor Pritzker, and I'm talking to President Biden. And I want you to understand that as we run into this upcoming political year, where the Democratic Party is on the menu, hear me. People of Chicago, of Illinois, and of the United States, it is time for us as Black people to stop voting party.
Come on.
It is time for us to stop voting color.
Yes. It is time for us to start voting our self-interest.
Yes. Yes.
And if the Democrats in the city of Chicago, the state of Illinois, and the country of USA refuses to listen to us, then it is time for us to start looking at other alternatives.
Hey.
People, we are looking at other alternatives.
Yes.
We will not step aside and continue to be mistreated. We will not continue to be disrespected. I'm looking at people who are coming here from another country, given work visas, given social security cards. Nobody is asking them what walk of life that they come from. You don't think that our brothers who have been in prison, who have come out and who have changed their lives, will benefit from the same opportunities that we are giving these migrants? And I'm not saying that they don't deserve those opportunities, but what I am saying is we deserve them first.
Yes.
What I am saying is you can't continue to put us on the back burner and think that we're going to continue to be okay with it. We've done that for long enough. Yeah. And what we're saying here today, and that is no longer acceptable.
Good.
We're saying to our city, we're saying to our governor that you're not going to continue to set monies aside for people who don't live here and disrespect, mistreat, and forget about us.
Amen.
You've forgotten about us.
Yep.
You have treated us as if we don't matter. And we're saying to you, you're not going to continue to do this. We're saying to you to see us. You're dumping people into our communities who are going to at some point move us out of the way. And what I say to you, if you want a glimpse into what's going to happen, look at how people of color are being treated in Venezuela right now. We seem to forget that Venezuela was one of the first places that had African slaves that they were taken to. We're forgetting about that. And so we're forgetting that there are blacks in Venezuela who are being treated the same way we are. And so for us to expect that they're going to come here and be put into our society and treat us differently is a pipe dream.
It's Jessica Jackson, and I'm a member of the community over here on the south side. I want to say that this problem is bigger than any alderman that's sitting in city council. This is an attack on the black community by the Democratic Party, and it's an attack on the citizens of this city.
Yeah.
Our rights are being violated. Our civil rights are being violated. There is no law that allows for non-citizens to come into our communities, force themselves into our communities, force themselves into public accommodations, force themselves into schools that could have been open for our children.
Right.
The constant discrimination against black people has to stop. I'm at the city council meetings all the time. I have yet to see any black official, any Hispanic official, any white official stand up and say that this is a violation against the civil rights of our citizens in this city or the citizens in Chicago, in the United States of America. We had an incident day before yesterday with a young man named Michael Young Bay, who was doing what many of you are doing right now, filming in a public building in City Hall, filming a public official, Alderman Greg Mitchell. Greg Mitchell did not like being filmed, and he made an aggressive attack on Michael. Michael went to jail. He went to jail because he asked to file a report on Greg Mitchell. Now, we all witnessed a few days before then where the Brighton community had an attack against that alderman. No arrests were made. We all witnessed when the Palestinians were protesting in City Hall about the war between Palestine and Israel. We witnessed them jumping and fighting the police. No arrests was made. It's all anchored in the fact that those people, they have a whole different political platform than black people do. Those people have protections from their countries. They have embassies, They have consulates. The United States is in treaties with these people. All kind of deals. So America handles them lightly. Black America only has the United States of America for our government. And our government is failing us. We fought for the civil rights laws in this country. We fought for the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment. We fought for the freedoms of this country, and yet we're the last ones that's reaping the benefits of it. I was told by our alderman, Stephanie Coleman, that the money for the Southwest Side Invest, the 320 that's a million that's supposed to be earmarked, which we later found out was $2.2 billion. She tells me that that money is a hoax. Well, if it's a joke, you need to go find our real money. Because
go find our money. Go find our money. You know, they got billions for everybody. No money for us. They got to have a committee to study if we deserve reparation. This is the shenanigans that we're dealing with, family. This is why I say you have to vacate the vote. You have to vacate the vote until they put your agenda front and center. You have to go in with an or else mentality. Shout out to the brothers and sisters in the city of Chicago. They like, you know, enough with the shenanigans. Enough is enough. You see it clear. That means they had billions that they could have paid out to us a long time ago. But in our ignorance and how you use political power, we voted for everyone else except for us. We did it to ourselves. So, you know, I'm glad a lot of people are waking up and saying no more, no more. Brother Ty, your thoughts on this committee in Chicago?
Well, you know, I applaud it. And I support them 100% wholeheartedly. And I'm glad they have the historical reference to pull it all together so it don't sound like a bunch of hooting and hollering, yelling for no reason. It can't really make logical sense of it all. I'm glad you brought up Dr. Claude Anderson because he said that this would happen. See, we're, think today or yesterday, an old Facebook post came up where I said, I don't let my enemies pick my enemies. When everybody was hating on Trump, talking about the Trump campaign and dumb Trump and all this foolishness, look, they're all the same. But one thing I will say about Trump, he made sure everybody got a few dollars in their pockets, their little stimulus checks, little PPP loans, your little extra bonus to your unemployment. And he said, keep the borders closed. He said, let's take care of the people here in America first. People were offended. I mean, he did typical white man stuff. He said to the African-American community, your schools are horrible, your neighborhoods are shitty. What do you got to lose? Vote for me. I mean, and he was right, though. He was right. And I'm glad Black folks is waking up, you know, divorcing these political parties. I wish they would do more research on these political parties to really find out who's who and what's what. But it's more important now than ever that we organize, because they done opened the floodgates. So other people are going to come in and by virtue just knock us out the box with their numbers. And that's what they intend to do. Again, I say this almost every week. We saw this 100 years ago when they sent for the Southern Europeans. All the people who are considered white today were not considered white 100 years ago. And now they're giving Hispanic people the option to identify as white. That's why you see some Spanish folks who say, I'm Afro-Latino. I'm not just Latino. I'm Afro-Latino. I am Black. I'm Latino, but I am Black, because they understand how racism works. Like we talked about last week, there's a difference between racism and white supremacy. We're dealing with racism. White supremacy is just a thought process, is an idea. Doesn't necessarily make it true. Racism is real. We're experiencing it. And they're bringing in all of these people to knock us out the box. Rather than pay us reparations, they get these people who are not historically tied to the foundation of this country. So they don't have a legitimate gripe. They're just happy to be here. And they'll take anything that's handed to them. Meanwhile, they're creating these committees to see if we deserve reparations, when it's already on the books that we were going to get reparations, the 40 acres and the mule. Lincoln was murdered. Johnson came into office and said, nah, y'all dead. Just like the same thing happened with the Civil Rights Bill when Kennedy was murdered. And Lyndon B. Johnson said, nah, y'all dead. I'll sign this, but include everybody else. Yeah, y'all was getting y'all head bust. Y'all was getting y'all ass kicked. But thank you, because we including everybody, including white women. White women were labeled as a minority. So now when money goes out to minority groups, white women be the first in line. So you don't think these white men are going to give their money to their wives, their daughters, and their sisters? It's the three card money they playing on us. And we're not socially or politically aware to see the game that they constantly running on us, because they got us indoctrinated with entertainment and sports. That's all we really care about. You can't even talk about professionals in the community because we don't recognize or fully respect the professionals in our communities. We love the entertainers. So when there's something going on, they'll give you a Snoop Dogg in the game to speak on it. They'll let Cardi B be a political voice for our community, as opposed to real politicians, real community activists, people who have a track record of organizing for our community. But I digress.
Sister Marcia, you said those exact words a couple of weeks ago on the show. We was talking about this very topic. So, you know, it's good to see that you were in tune with, you see how the ancestors work? You know, something is resonating with a lot of folks. A lot of people are waking up. Millions of us are waking up around the globe. The ancestors are definitely shaking the earth. You know, you just got to listen, pay attention. But someone had put in the chat that, you know, Sister Manera, she says, it's time for mass movements across the U.S. Absolutely. It's been time. She said, how many studies are they going to have about reparations? Something to cut the check. But, you know, some states are trying to come up with models, right? So we said many times on this platform, it's going to be very important that you understand your genealogy. Those of us who do genealogical research, shout out to Dr. Randy Short, who does genealogical research also. We're going to be in high demand. Trust me on that. You know why? Here's a breakdown of a synopsis of what could happen. Let's hear it, family. We'll come back and we'll discuss.
In section one, we will cover the limited number of cities and states who are having serious discussions around reparations. In section two, we will cover the creative ways that they are calculating reparations owed to Black Americans. In section three, we will show you how to use the California Reparations Calculator with real live data. And in the last section, we will cover how you can potentially qualify for a reparations package. Bear in mind that this is a hypothetical use case for calculating and qualifying for reparations. At the time of this video, there have been only a dozen cities who have even taken up this subject. The idea of atoning for the sins of slavery has been around since 1865. After the Civil War, Union leaders concluded that each Black family should receive 40 acres, and some families were to receive mules left over from the war. President Andrew Johnson, however, reversed the order and returned the land back to former slave owners. Without question, reparation packages for Black Americans should be designed, legalized, and distributed at the federal level. The United States Congress has a moral and legal obligation to provide reparations for the enslavement of Africans and its lasting effects. There is a $14 trillion bill on the table, but many doubt that it will ever see the light of day. But some cities and local municipalities are taking it upon themselves to apologize for slavery. Some cities and local municipalities are being proactive and progressive, making amends for both the local and federal government's role in denying wealth-building opportunities for Black people. And yet, there are other cities who are forming committees and task forces to determine how a reparations program can be funded and implemented. Here are three governments that are pioneering paths and making significant progress in providing reparation packages to their Black citizens. We want to spend a little time describing their proposals, since these are likely to become national models that your city or state could adopt. Number one, the state of California. The state of California is taking some very bold steps. They have formed the first state-appointed task force in the nation to explore how a state could make reparations to African Americans hurt by slavery. And they have even gone as far as to design an online calculator to help determine what a reparation payout would look like. Number two, the city of Evanston, Illinois. The city of Evanston, Illinois has already approved their reparations program. However, they are less focused on slavery and want to help reverse some of the damage caused by discriminatory housing policies and practices. Their program is believed to be the first of its kind in the U.S. and is a potential national model to help Black Americans build wealth through home ownership. Number three, the city of San Francisco. San Francisco supervisors have backed the idea of paying reparations to its Black citizens in lump sum payments of $5 million. But it's just a proposal for now with a list of qualifications where you must meet two of the eight criteria to be eligible. But first, let's discuss how reparations are calculated. If your city or state follows the framework of the California Reparations Task Force, you may be provided with an online calculator to help you estimate the amount of reparations that you qualify for. This calculator uses certain criteria to determine the amount that you have lost due to generations and decades of systemic racism. Here are the five criteria that California is factoring in. Health harm. This is derived from the difference in life expectancy between Black and white residents. For example, in California, whites live 7.6 years longer than Blacks, and therefore, this loss of time will be compensated for. Mass incarceration and over-policing. This is derived from average salary for a state employee because incarcerated individuals were forced to provide unpaid labor for the state, plus loss of freedom compensation. The time frame corresponds to the national war on drugs. Housing discrimination. This is derived from the homeownership wealth gap from state-facilitated discriminatory redlining, unfair zoning, and prejudicial home lending practices. Devaluation of businesses. This is estimated from missed opportunities and wealth built through Black business establishments and the potential business profits. Unjust property takings. The task force highlighted several instances of eminent domain and unjust taking, but at the time of this video, the task force was not provided enough data to provide a specific calculation. But let's play with the numbers. Let's pretend that you do actually live in California and you live there for a minimum of 6 months of each year from 1950 to 2020. After entering the years of eligibility, notice that the reparations calculator automatically quantifies the amount of monetary damage that is due to you. So here is the final sum that would be owed to you per the California formula. It's a grand total of $1,381,198. That's nothing to sneeze at. Now let's see how much you would qualify for if you were born in 1970, 1980, and 1990, respectively. Again, we want to remind you that this could be your package if your city or state adopts the reparations proposal that's before California. After watching the rest of this video, pull up the calculator and enter the values for you and your family members using the link in the description box below. But we may be putting the cart before the horse. Do you actually qualify for reparations? It really depends. But let's go through the 10 potential qualification points that we extracted from the reparation plans developed by California, San Francisco, and Evanston. Number one, you must be a descendant of an enslaved African American. Only those individuals who are the descendants of enslaved African Americans can be eligible for monetary reparations. You will have to prove that you are in the lineage of someone who was enslaved through U.S. chattel slavery before 1865. Senior citizens will be given priority, and recent Black immigrants do not qualify. This is a requirement established by the California's Reparations Task Force for the California Reparations Program. If your city or state adopts their framework, then they will establish a new African American Freedmen Affairs agency dedicated to not only implementing the reparation program, but also properly carrying out any policies adopted into law. This new agency would also carry the legal responsibility of helping applicants determine their eligibility. The agency would have a genealogy branch to support potential reparations applicants by providing access to expert genealogical research to confirm reparations eligibility. Number two, you must be a descendant of a free African American living prior to 1900. If you are not the descendant of an enslaved Black American, you can also be eligible for reparations if you can prove that you are the descendant of a free African American who was living in the United States prior to 1900. This is an exception that was adopted by the California Reparation Task Force. Number three, you must be at least 18 years old. If your city or state adopts the framework established by San Francisco, California, then in order to receive reparations, you must not only be African American, a descendant of an enslaved person, but you must be at least 18 years old. There must exist public documents where you have identified as either Black or African American for at least 10 years. Number four, you must prove residency for at least 13 years. If your city or state adopts the reparations framework adopted by San Francisco, then you would have to be born in the city or state or have migrated there between 1940 and 1996. If this holds true, then you will have to show proof of at least 13 years of residency. Number five, you must prove economic or health inequities. If your city or state adopts the reparations framework proposed by San Francisco, you could receive reparations if you can prove that your race is a factor in you not earning the average income or wealth threshold for your city or state. Also, if you can demonstrate that you lack access or proximity to quality educational opportunities, you may become eligible. And lastly, your city or state may target reparations for Black citizens who lived in specific zip codes, regions, or communities that have historically experienced particularly intense discrimination or violence. Number six, you were incarcerated by the failed war on drugs. If you were arrested and incarcerated during the 1980s as part of the Reagan administration's failed war on drugs, then you are eligible for reparations. And if you are a direct descendant of someone who was incarcerated, you would be eligible for reparations if your city or state is using San Francisco's reparation program as a framework. Seven, your family was displaced or land seized by the government. If your city or state were to follow the San Francisco framework, thousands of Black families would receive reparations if they lost their homes, land, farms, and businesses due to the local and federal government claiming their property under the power of eminent domain. You would also qualify if your family suffered from environmental injustices after corporations moved their refineries, landfills, and power plants in close proximity of Black neighborhoods, bringing in contaminated water, toxic chemicals, and air pollution. San Francisco also recognizes the structural racism where the local municipalities deliberately built interstates and highways that ran through the middle of thriving Black enclaves and business centers. The ripple effects damaged every aspect of Black lives, cultural, economic, environmental, political, and educational for generations. Your city or state, like San Francisco, may seek to compensate any family that suffered damage to their pathway to build generational wealth, secure stable housing, and live freely and healthy. Number eight, you experienced lending discrimination or was a victim of redlining. If your city or state were to follow the San Francisco framework, you would be entitled to reparations if you personally experienced lending discrimination between the years 1937 and 1968, or if you were a resident of a formerly redlined community between 1968 and 2008. Your city would officially identify the formerly redlined community to help you determine your eligibility. And
so, family, as you see, you know, you are going to have to prove your genealogy. It's very important that you get your family history and legacy. You better know it. You know, I love going around my family members and asking questions, and I record them. You know, we had a family gathering not too long ago, and I was questioning, you know, my aunts and cousins about, you know, things that happened in the past with the family and the family background. And actually found out that someone in the Purdue family murdered one of my family members just from asking questions.
The Purdue chicken people?
The Purdue chicken people murdered a family member of mine.
PCP.
So, you know, hey, you got to know your history. So don't be afraid, you know, when you're around your family, you have these family gatherings. That's what it's for. Start asking questions. You know, what happened to grandma? Where grandma from? And so and so.
Yo, sis, you know, it's so crazy because I think I qualify on all scales.
Yes.
Every generation, the Reagan era, redlining, the enslavement.
I was saying the same thing to myself, right?
I thought you was an immigrant, Black. I thought you was a first generation New Yorker.
He has first, money claiming otherwise.
First wrong site.
Hold up. You or more. You
but yo, that's real talk though. Real talk. I'm gonna tell you why. When my moms and pops had my first, I'm the third of four. When my moms and pops, both of them was born in Harlem. I was the first one born in the Bronx. I have my younger brother too. But he grew up upstate more than he did in the Bronx.
Okay.
So. Somebody put in the chat, well, tell Tariq it's time to change his identity again.
Yeah, you got ripped off, right? That's funny. That's right. Nah, they wasn't a slave. So when they giving out that money, I do not want to see none of them in line. You know what I'm saying? They ain't got no jurisdiction over you, sucker polite. Ain't that what he was selling to the people?
How about if they won 16 Black and they got the one drop rule in there? What about that?
Nah, we ain't doing that. I ain't never subscribed to that. But I mean, I like the system that they have in place. And Sister Keisha, I think you opened the video with what I was saying. I knew it was one of them Johnsons that knew we were supposed to give reparations, but reversed it like they always do. And that's my point. It's the same tricks time and time again. They know we're owed these things. And they think by bringing in South American immigrants that they're just going to flush us out and make us forget, because they have a whole new workforce that they don't even have to pay minimum wage to. They know they're making their money under the table, because this is how the elites are benefiting. They're getting free slave labor again. Did you see the video? It was taken down. I have reposted it, where the white guy tried to give the brother $10 for working 3 hours. Wow. And the brother slapped fire out the old dude.
No, I didn't see that. Oh, my God.
It was a brother. He was working for this older white gentleman. I'm being politically correct. He's working with an older white gentleman. And he tried to give him $10. And the dude was like, y'all work for me for 3 hours. You're going to give me $10? And he recorded and said, yo, y'all see you trying to give me $10. And smack fire out the old dude. I was like, ooh.
But check this out, though. You know, when you get old, I don't know how old the guy was. I'm assuming he was a little younger than us. But at the same time, you got to negotiate with people and discuss those things and then see if they real. So if you have to, you work for him again because he's honorable. He honored everything he said he was going to do. Or get what the hell he feel you worth. And that's what he felt you was worth.
Yeah. No, I agree with you 100%, Brother Black. And that's part of the problem we have as a community, our lack of communication, where we don't negotiate. We don't even know how to negotiate. We don't even know that negotiating is an art. You know, right. It's a skill. In fact, I was talking to Kayla the other day about hard skills and soft skills. Right. Just about how everybody can acquire soft skills. Soft skills are things like manners and being respectful, polite, speaking when you walk in the room, knowing
customer service.
Right. That, you know, proper etiquette is soft skills. Anybody can do that. Hard skills are the labor skills, you know, knowing how to operate a forklift, computer programming, visual art. Those are hard skills, things that not everybody can do.
Right.
And this is the thing. We don't understand hard skills and soft skills. So to negotiate. I'm sorry, Sister Marcia.
I'm sorry. Continue. And when you're done, I'm sorry.
No, but my point was to build on what Brother Blacklick was saying, in addition to us not negotiating that, because I mean, I would have smacked fire out of two. That is very important. You know, if somebody say, yo, I need you to do some work for me, how much does it pay? Because if you're going to tell me you're going to give me $10 for 3 hours worth of work, I'm good, homie. I'm good. But again, this white guy, you can tell he's from a generation where you probably give a black guy a quarter and make him work all day. Say, I paid you good money. You know, so these are things, and this is why what we do here on this program is very important, because we give you historical context to make it all tie in together and make it relate to what we're dealing with today. Because a lot of our folks don't get this information nowhere else. And when they do get it, it's all convoluted about who we are as a people. They playing identity politics. That's why I said the Moors better not get in line when they start, if they decide to start giving out money. Because again, we'll have to take it before they'll voluntarily give it to us. You know, Malcolm said, if you're a man, you take your freedom.
Okay, now.
I'm gonna step off my soapbox.
Let me say this real quick to what you're saying directly, Tad. Mm-hmm. Remember, there's going to be a cosmic element to add to all what we're talking about as well. We're not going to have to put hands on them like that and all that. They pretty much out of here.
Just Thanos, cosmically, hold on. Cosmically, they out of here?
Thanos. Bryson,
I just need to say this now. With all due respect, that sound Christian-like. We got to wait for somebody else to do what we could do for ourselves.
Right.
God worked through the hands of man. Whether it's God or the alien named Vishnu, they worked through the hands of man. Nobody ever seen God come down and do anything himself. God used people like Dr. Khaled and Malcolm and Muhammad Ali and Kimbo Slice.
Yeah, of course. No, bro. My point is not to say don't do what you do. My point is to say that's in addition to what you're talking about as well, not negate one for the other.
Okay.
Now, if you run up on Tommy Sotomayor or, you know, somebody that might get hands put on them wherever they go in this country, you know what I'm saying? Do what you do. You know, I'm not saying I'm like KRS-One when he said that the violence isn't necessary. But sometimes it is, when he went and attacked PM Dawn on the stage.
Right. Yes. Right. Sometimes it's necessary.
You got to do what you got to do, bro.
As a friend once asked me, she said, who 51 out here still fighting? And I said, me. Me. As long as these hands can operate.
Bark them.
With the strength of God.
All day long.
Sister Marcia, you had something you wanted to say.
Yeah, hey, let me say this real quick. Bobby Hammett is always, he said this enough times in different places where it's like, this is what I'm thinking. He used to always get into arguments with Brother Khaled, God rest his soul, because he said, yo, everything ain't a fight, man. You know, we got to get them on the spiritual, the cosmic, everything else too. Yeah. And add it all in. Not just that, because, you know, when you tell Khaled something, he want to go and put the hammers up. You heard
the hammers on them. That's right.
Okay. That's all. I understand the energy and I love it. And I don't ever want you to do anything different.
You got
to
speak in the language that they understand.
Yo, okay.
Violence is it breaks language barriers. You tell somebody stop playing with you, they think you're joking until you punch him in the mouth. They're like, oh, you meant
in whatever language he's thinking, he's like, man, that dude getting his ass whipped.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the exact words, but in another language, you know.
It's a universal language.
Yes, sir.
Well, let's get Sister Marcia in the mic.
She just laughing. She ain't even saying nothing over here.
I was just saying that, you know, in the cosmic force, Thanos was going to come and snap his fingers and all those people were going to disappear. But, you know, and that would have been the ultimate fight for Brother Black. It's good. The only thing I wanted to add to in terms of soft and hard skills is accountability and responsibility. That is a hard skill for our people to learn. In order for us to go into these political realms with the, what happened?
You didn't see that picture?
I can't help it. Brother Tap sent me this afternoon. I was on the floor. What budget? This is Dex right here.
You didn't see that the first time?
Sorry about the N-word, Philly. Sorry,
hey, please send that. Hey, Sister Keisha, please send that to me later. Please, please. I need that one.
I thought Sister Keisha would get a kick out of that one.
Oh, it was from Pat. I thought it was from you, Sister Keisha. I'm sorry, Marcia. We interrupted you, like, violating wise.
Good. That is a bad hombre. That is a bad hombre. We're going to give Tad some fried chicken right now. We're going to give Tad some fried chicken to calm him down.
Uh-oh.
Calm him down, family.
So, I'm refined now. I want mine in palm oil.
Here
no more Crisco and lard for me. Fry mine in palm oil. I'm African.
Oil. We need some hot heat oil. You know what I'm saying? Not that grandma Crisco to make it crispy.
Yeah.
Off the back of the stove.
You need that soybean oil or that peanut oil for that.
In the can that's been sitting there for months. Don't
years.
Don't play.
Cooked last year's chicken with that.
It's the best. You know how much grease, how much chicken it went through?
Exactly.
It has all the flavoring.
But you got to keep it separate from the fish grease now.
Yes.
Don't mess it up.
What's the best flour to use on fried chicken?
Aunt Jemima. What you use?
Monk
they make
fruit
other
flour.
What?
Monk fruit flour.
Talking about flour.
He getting vegan on us. Next thing you know, he vegan fried chicken.
It tastes better because it's seasoned and it's lighter.
Marcia, like,
Mike.
I can't even remember your name now. You're messing up the taste buds.
Man, well, I mean, you never ate it, though.
Flour.
Shots fired. Shots fired.
You'll find it if you look for it. It exists. I'm not making it up.
I believe you. That's the sad part.
No, I'm talking to Sister Marcia, man.
I'm with Sister Marcia.
She said I messed up her taste buds.
That's right. There is something about eating. When you want certain foods, you want it done authentically. When you want to, you know, spice it up and do something different, that's a different meal. That's not a fried chicken. That's not a whiting. That's not that. It's not that. It's different. Once you start adding different components, the food tastes different. It may be great. Great. But that's not what I was feeling. That's not what I wanted. I went into the restaurant and I went to buy fried chicken and you gave me some monk flour or something.
I said monk fruit flour.
I don't know what you said, but what
that's
said.
That's what I said.
What if it ain't Aunt Jemima, we don't want it. Don't give me no gold medal. Don't give me no spelt flour. I don't want none of that. I don't want nothing healthy with my fried chicken.
I'm a foodie. When I want something, I want it the way I want it.
That's right. And there's nothing wrong with that.
But you're trying to tell me to go get some monk flour.
I didn't tell you to go get it. I told you that's what I use.
But
when I said it, ain't nobody else but you felt like I told you to go get it.
I felt like that. I was offended.
I ain't talking to Tad no more tonight. He just clowning.
My God, I can't.
Sister Marcia, I'll argue with you later. How's that? I'm going to acknowledge everybody. Sister Keisha ain't participating, so I'm putting her out of it.
This
Sister
is Keisha not,
about to mute you.
I'm drinking water and minding my business.
This is love, not an argument.
Sister Keisha, what you was going to say about the fried chicken before he came up in here with that
bronze? You know what I'm saying? Like this is why you got to prove your genealogy, Black. You already got a strike against you messing up the fried chicken.
He ain't getting no check because he from the Bronx. They don't count.
Hold on, family. Let's look at a little bit of history on fried chicken. Here we go, family. Come back and discuss.
Didn't have to do with race. Don't white people like fried chicken? And what's so offensive about fried chicken? Well, today we're going to talk about the history of African Americans and fried chicken. And if you like stories like this, you can find more stories like this at onemikehistory.com. Also, if you like to support the channel, you can do so at my Buy Me Coffee, my Patreon page in the description below. Give us 5 stars on our podcast and support the YouTube channel. But without further ado, Let's get started. The concept of fried chicken goes all the way back to ancient Rome. A Roman cookbook named the Abacus was the first to suggest the recipe of fried chicken. However, it was the Moors who truly developed and refined the art of frying chicken in the Mediterranean. Traditional fried chicken as we know it has its origins in two distinct cultures, Scottish and West African. The Scots were the first to introduce the idea of frying chicken, which was quite different from the usual European cooking methods of baking and broiling. There was evidence that the Scots had been deep frying poultry in fat since the Middle Ages. An interesting piece of evidence from 1773 diary of the writer James Boswell wrote about a dinner he had in the Isle of Skye, which included fried chicken. One of the very first known written recipes of fried chicken comes in a British cookbook entitled The Art of Cookery, Made Plain and Easy by Hannah Glass in 1747. The recipe, loved by both British and the American colonies, in the recipe calls to cut two pieces of chicken into quarters, lay them in vinegar for 2 to 4 hours with salt, pepper, a bay leaf, and cloves of garlic, very thick batter, first with a half a pint of wine and flour, then 2 egg yolks, melt a little butter, grated oregano, some chopped parsley, beat very well, dip your fowls in the batter, and fry them up in a good deal of hog lard. While it was Scottish immigrants who first introduced fried chicken to the United States, they were definitely not the ones that popularized it. That was done by Western Africans. During that time period, Western Africans were very familiar with cooking chicken, and they usually used a braising technique. However, once in America, enslaved Africans used their culinary traditions to introduce the concepts of seasoning and spices and imbue the flavor and zest into an otherwise mundane dish. See, at the time, the Scots weren't putting any seasoning in their fried chicken. Upon arrival, enslaved people found themselves in an alien landscape amidst an unfamiliar food and culinary norms. Nonetheless, they were expected to utilize the ingredients that were accessible to them while continuing to draw on their deep culinary traditions. African culinary habits bustling featured poultry and fowl, and chicken played a significant role, making this an easily adaptable ingredient when they reached the New World. Their culinary skill and ingenious improvisation of the enslaved people played a huge role in the growth and popularity of fried chicken. They combined their African cooking techniques with already available ingredients in America to create something completely different. For example, West African cultures use palm oil most often for frying foods. However, in America, enslaved Africans had to switch to using lard or pig fat or fat of other animals to fry chicken. This was because those ingredients were more readily available and less expensive. Chickens also played a significant part in the lives of enslaved people. Chickens were amongst the few animals that enslaved people were permitted to keep and care for, and they became a key part of their meals. Raising chickens was manageable and presented enslaved people with an opportunity to express some level of independence. Chickens also had economic importance because sometimes enslaved people were allowed to trade or sell their surplus eggs and meat for other goods. However, if a chicken fell sick or died, enslaved people were forced to eat it to avoid wasting the food. Therefore, they came up with the idea of cleaning and seasoning the meat, then frying it in hot oil. During slavery, fried chicken was a luxury reserved for special occasion. Although the recipe is extremely simple, preparing it took a lot of time and effort. Not everyone had access to the right kitchen tools or even access to available poultry. Still, as more and more people tasted fried chicken, it began to disseminate across the South. And by the end of the Civil War, the connection between African Americans and fried chicken was already firmly established. In the period following the Civil War, mass-produced fried chicken and inexpensive oils became readily available. However, during the same time period, racial laws restricted employment opportunities for African Americans, particularly women. So they resorted to selling their homemade fried chicken, often considered Sunday meal, to travelers. This economic strategy helped propagate Southern railways and therefore solidify fried chicken as a Southern staple and a nationwide symbol. The best example of this took place in Gordonville, Virginia. Despite this small town of only 900 residents, Gordonville, Virginia was an important stop were two major railroad lines. During that time period, trains did not have dining cars, so passengers had to figure out how to feed themselves, and some would pack their own food, while others chose to purchase meals during their trip. Spotting a business opportunity, African-American women used to sell their homemade food to passing travelers. They would serve fried chicken and pies and biscuits and deliver them to the hands of passengers on a platform through the train windows. The women were known as waiter carriers. But by the turn of the century, majority of the trains began to equip with dining cars, and governmental regulations became more stringent for platform food vendors. And as a result, this innovative business tradition had to come to an end. During the Great Migration.
I just wanted to give a little bit of background on the history of fried chicken, you know, just so that we can understand, you know, the historical reference, where it all comes from, you know. So, you know, your thoughts, Sister Marcia, on that piece.
I think fried chicken is the best. Unfortunately, Haitian people don't really know how to make fried chicken. So I go outside of my population for fried chicken. We make chicken and we fry it, but it's not the good fried chicken from my brothers and sisters of America. And I love it. That's all I have to say.
I think Sister Marcia is crazy serious about chicken.
Oh, I'm absolutely serious about my chicken. Absolutely serious about my chicken. It makes sense.
Sister Marcia and Brother Tad don't play about their food, Black. I'm just telling you from experience.
I don't either.
No, yes, you do.
I don't either. I've worked in plenty of restaurants. I never wanted to cook.
Bro, you eat monk fruit flour. I ain't never heard of that.
Man, I'm going to send y'all a link. Y'all keep thinking I'm playing.
But wait a minute. Dr. Filet said, question, and make you go, question, if it's dead, what could it do for you? When you eat it, just a thought.
Fill your belly.
Hey, Dr. Filet, we love you and all that, but right now we're not trying to have that conversation. Real talk.
I'm like Marcia
right now with the vigorousness right now.
On that note, I agree. And all my brothers and sisters who are vegan, I appreciate eating a vegan meal, but when I'm having my fried chicken, well, my fried fish, catfish, biting, I want it done correctly. And sometimes as a Caribbean person, I understand that all Caribbeans, there's something that you can't do. Accept it and move on. And frying chicken is one thing that they can't do. Even like fried whitings or catfish, they can't do that. They make their own little thing and it tastes good, but it's not the same as a good Southern. I went to in Texas. Oh my God, this sister made the absolute best fried food I've ever had. And I never, like, I would travel to Texas any day or every day if that's what I wanted. I need to pay her a visit because that was some good food. I traveled. Okay. That's what I got to say. Is Sister Frozen?
No. Brother Black.
Yeah, what's up, bro?
Oh, I think Sister...
I'm here.
I think Sister Keisha might be
frozen. Maybe Sister Keisha. She the one been having internet problems lately. Oh. Remember last week she dropped out for a good 10, 15 minutes?
Yeah.
And then we started arguing.
It's the cosmic radiation, brother.
Thanos came, snapped the finger.
Oh, see, there y'all go. It's the solar flash.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's frozen.
It didn't hit the Bronx or Brooklyn, it just went to Harlem. That's it. Only Black people in Harlem is now woke.
Well, look, I love my chicken. I love it for the protein. I love it for the flavor, the crisps, the crunchiness. Shout out to all my vegans. Me, Sister Keisha, and Brother Ashe went out to dinner one night. And they was on their vegan stuff. And I was like, yeah, y'all have lettuce and tomatoes all y'all want. I had oxtails of rice and peas and ting and plantains and all of that. You know, I ate real food. And I say this in jest, but I'm serious about it. We keep talking about wars and fighting this and fighting that. We scared to kill and eat animals. We definitely ain't ready for these bloodthirsty people. I'm with it all. And When they start destroying the planet and your crops can't grow because of Monsanto, eating them GMO carrots, I'm going to have to start doing a little Chinese delicacy, and Cujo going to look a little flavorful if it come down to it.
Not Cujo. Let's get all of those folks. But not, I'm not ready for dog and cat, because then I can go back to the Chinese food. I'm good with that.
You was raised on it. Cut it out. You was raised on Chinese food. You was 3 years old, and they gave you a chicken bone from the Chinese restaurant while you was teething. Chomp on that.
I heard only in the Bronx, man, that milk we was getting in public school was rat milk. It wasn't cow milk at all.
Y'all had powdered rat milk?
No, rat milk, not powder.
You had rat
that's
milk?
That's all they sell in the Bronx is powder.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to tell you. I said rat.
For you. Catholic schools, they didn't give you had to carry your own lunch. They weren't feeding the students. You had to carry your own lunch. And I'm sorry that you had to drink some rat milk. That sounds gross. But, yeah.
Welcome to the Bronx.
Sister Marie Maiman, she says she's up in the Bronx. She up partying up in the Bronx.
But I want to get back to this chicken thing.
We still on chicken.
You used to, because we're not doing that rat stuff. That's why they all own Chinese restaurants up there now in the Bronx.
Thank you, brother.
But in all seriousness, you see how they'll say it came from European folks, which could be true, but see how anytime we put our hands on something, we spice it up, season it up, and we make it a delicacy, no matter what it is. Me, I stay away from the hog, but for those who eat chitterlings or ever had it, I never had it before. Thank goodness. That's all I'm gonna say. But no matter what they give us, out of our sheer will to survive, because I mean, I joke about the dog, right, Sister Marcia? But you think about it. What we've really been through here in America, where Black folks really had to eat pig intestines and pig testicles, and pig noses, ears, and tails. That's a real thing. And who's to say these folks won't revert back to their nature? Because they are in control of the food supply. They are in control of the water supply. We have to be mindful. They are literally trying to replace us. They never stopped their plan for genocide. So I say all that to say, though I say it in jest, joking around, but the reality is, are we really prepared to do what it takes to survive to the next day? Because that's what our ancestors had to do.
I know that's
and
right.
We joke about it, and we have to. We have to laugh to keep from crying. But these creature comforts and these luxuries we have right now, what would we do if these folks decide to snatch them all away right now? Because today is Palestine, tomorrow it could be Brooklyn.
That's right.
It's a real deal out here, and we know this animal we're dealing with. I'm gonna step off my soapbox.
No, you're absolutely right, Brother Tad. And what's most?
No, I'm joking. I'm joking. I'm teasing. But go ahead, sis.
I'm done.
I think Sister Manera done got Marcia riled up. She said, "Substitute chicken for some fried oyster mushrooms."
Thanks. I want some fried oyster mushroom some other day. I'd rather some real oysters. That's my fave. You know, sometimes I like real food. I'm not saying food isn't food, but sometimes I want the flavor that I was accustomed to, not the next generation of flavor.
Say that part again.
The next generation of flavor.
We was in at an event one day, and this brother had this dope outfit on, right? Sister Keisha, check it out. He rolled up like, yo, he's like, yo, I like that jacket. He's like, yeah, this is vegan leather. Yeah. Yo, me and Doggy looked at each other like, you mean to say that's pleather? Like, we don't do vegan leather around here. It's pleather. Just say your food is fake, your clothes is fake. All that is. Come on, man. Come on, where do we?
It's banana fibered.
It's not banana fibered. That was pleather.
It was
Michael Jackson jacket in 84. It was pleather.
It's great. I appreciate your stuff, but don't try to, you know, bait me with the falseness, like you're saying, Brother Tad.
Right.
It's or say, you know, it's this is whatever. I don't know.
These I used to be a vegetarian. I was never vegan. I was a vegetarian before, and that just that don't do well at cookouts. You know what I'm saying? I'm not just eating grilled corn all day. You can give me one of them cheeseburgers and you can have a veggie chicken.
You can have a veggie burger.
Nope. That ain't real burgers. That brother, is not a real burger. That stuff brother is made in a peach tree dish.
Brother it's Black.
Yes, ma'am.
What do you really enjoy eating?
Black eat everything.
Don't eat ham. I don't eat pork.
Yeah, I don't eat pork. The last time I ate pork, I was 15 years old.
Yeah, I don't eat pork neither.
Yeah.
But
I don't eat shrimp either.
I was never rocking with the chitlins and all of that. Never.
Nah, I never ate that ever.
Once I had to sit there with my grandmother and clean them, listen. I'm thankful to be alive because I thought I was going
to
throw
up. We did have to eat fat back, though. We had to eat fat back and spam, though. So I don't know how much
fried fat back.
I used to chew. Yeah, I used to chew the hard part.
Hey, listen, I want to talk about a dish that most people that live in America don't talk about, especially if they was born and raised in America. It's called fufu in Africa. In my my parents are from Honduras, from the Garifuna people, and they call it hudutu. Now I'm sure they make a version of it in Haiti, Marcia. What would that be?
Tom-tom.
Okay, so yeah, it's basically they pound plantains and then they make a soup with whatever meat you like, and then you eat it together, like, you know, with the plantain, you dip it into the soup.
Yeah, the Nigerians call it swallow.
Okay, yeah. All over Africa, generally, it's called something like fufu. In Africa, it's fufu. I don't care what language you talk about it in. Anybody you tell fufu, they know how to make it.
Yeah, it's only pounded yams with no seasons, and they pound it into a little thing. It's good, but I don't know.
It's called mofongo, right?
How? Yes. Like mofongo.
The Puerto Ricans. That's how the Puerto Ricans call it.
Yeah, but mofongo is made with plantains.
Yeah, that's the one I talked about is fufu too. It's the same concept. Some people make it with yams, some people make it with plantain. Over here, because plantains are more available, they'll probably make it with plantains on this side of the world more. That grows everywhere. You know they call Dominicans platanos?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Facts. Let's look at the history of the barbecue. Shout out to the Caribbean massive. Here we go.
Oh, it can be traced back to native tribes in the Caribbean and their indigenous cooking methods. The first Spanish colonizers embarked on their New World voyages in the 15th century. They were fascinated by the techniques employed by the indigenous people. The Native Americans would slow cook their meat over wooden structures over a pit of fire. This method was termed barbacoa, and this enthralled colonizers so much that they incorporated barbacoa into their Spanish lexicon, with it eventually becoming the word barbecue. The story of barbecue doesn't end with Spanish colonizers. These explorers took the cooking method of barbacoa with them to North America, where it was adopted by the local people and colonizers alike. The first known written mention of pork barbecue was around Mississippi. The book, The Historical Roots of the Yaknak Tapapa, 1540-1962, authors Don Harrison Doyle wrote in December of 1540, near present-day Tupelo, Mississippi, the explorer Hernando de DeSoto and the Chickasaw tribe had a feast of Spanish cooked pork using the barbacoa method. By the 16th and 17th centuries, barbecue had become an integral part of everyday life in the southern part of North America, where there's even a painting from 16th century French explorer Jacques Lemoyne that shows Native Americans in Florida using a wooden frame over burning logs to cook a variety of foods like fish, mammals, and reptiles. George Washington, who was once charged with procuring meat for his soldiers during the French and Indian Wars, even talked about barbecuing in the Indian manner. With the arrival of enslaved Africans to the Americas in the 16th century, this caused a significant shift in the cultural and culinary landscape. Forced to adapt to a strange new environment, these Africans learned to sustain themselves through ingenious methods. They closely observed the cooking methods of the Native Americans, specifically the technique of barbecuing. This slow-cooked method was ideal for larger cuts of meat, which made it popular for communal gatherings. It's around this time that the groundwork was laid for the Southern style of pit barbecuing. However, the adaption from the Native American techniques of suspended racks to in-pit barbecue is very murky. There is scant written references from the 18th century to shed light on this evolution. But despite the lack of documentation, it's plausible that this move into the ground was an inevitable progression. Around the same time was the introduction of unique African flavors and cooking techniques into barbecue by the enslaved community. Enslaved Africans didn't just learn Native American techniques of barbecuing, but they contributed their own, like the process of smoking meat over a gentle flame. It was a common practice in several African cultures and was originally designed to preserve the freshness of meat. This method eventually fused with the open pit cooking style that formed the basis for the barbecue style that we know today. Southern barbecue would gain popularity around the mid-1700s on Virginia plantations and then slowly make its way south from there. However, it's important to know that barbecues were not a regular event, but they were organized around holidays, special events, and political gatherings.
A little bit of backstory on the history of barbecue. On the history of barbecue, family. So, you know, on Thorough Black Talk, we keep it thorough over here. You got to give the history. You got to give the background. Shout out to the indigenous family out there also. Sister Marcia, your thoughts on that piece?
I think fabulous yet again. And also, I don't remember what documentary that I was reading, but watching. They were talking about the naming of the gods, and one of the netters, I want to say it's, which one is the jackal? Ampu? Ampu was the, he would make sure that meats were ready to eat. So the folks of Kemet would bury their meats in the depths of the hot sand, and he would let them know when the meats were ready to be pulled out and be served for the people. And one of the things that I find, even when I eat other people's cuisines, there's some dryness about continental food. And I think that has to do with the slow cooking of it. So the meats are a little tough, but still good. So I just found that interesting. And also, for someone who went to Hawaii, did you see them cooking in the pit? Because that they're known for putting the hogs and their meats in the pit for cooking. Did you?
Nope, I missed all that. I'm gonna be honest with you. I slept in Hawaii. I relaxed. That's Little good. Tad had the best time. Him and Kamaria, they had the best time. I slept. While everybody left, I slept. I slept well. So no, I didn't see that in Hawaii. I did the parasail. I'm sorry?
I said you needed the rest, but they're known for cooking. That's one of their major cooking methods.
Yes. Yes, it is. I know they do a lot of pineapple and guava over there.
No pineapple.
it was all good to me. But now, what's funny, in Ghana, though.
I told you he don't play about his food.
Now, yeah, but it will make me swell up. So if you want me to look like a gorilla.
Oh, no, we don't want that, sis. Now, in Ghana, I did taste what you're talking about, the dryness of the food, because the chicken tastes like chicken, not like the little Frankenbird we get over here. Mm-hmm. But real chicken. Mm-hmm. And they do cook it in palm oil without all the flour and the greasiness mm-hmm. of it all. And it was delicious. And there is a difference in the preparation of it. Mm-hmm. And another tidbit, because I know we wind it down. We didn't talk about baked macaroni. What I've learned last year is that a black man, an enslaved African, actually created baked macaroni. Mm-hmm. You know, so fried chicken and baked macaroni, there's reasons why these are staples in our diet. Though we should eat it in moderation now, because we're not eating natural foods like back then during our enslavement, where people lived to be over 100 years old with not the best nutritional diet that they had for the time. They definitely lived longer because it wasn't all this GMO chemical laboratory made stuff. That's why, you know, even though I joke about vegans and vegetarianism, no matter what we eat, we really got to be mindful and very careful, because we know that Obama had appointed the head of the one of the dudes from Monsanto to be the head of the FDA. And we know what Monsanto seeds do to the crops. In fact, in Ghana, they were telling me how they rejected the Monsanto seeds when they were brought over there, because they saw the seeds ripping the soil of its nutrients, that after a while, you can't even plant in the soil anymore, because Monsanto seeds destroys the soil of the earth. You know, so as we talk about food and dietary, I say this, man, eat what makes you happy. I'm not a food snob. You know what I'm saying? You eat pork, that's your business. I don't eat it. There's some things I don't eat, and there's things I eat that some people may not eat, you know? However, let's just really be mindful of what we're ingesting, because again, there's a genocidal attack on us, you know? As we open the show, Sister Keisha talk about the culture wars. And every week, this is what we're talking about. So this week, we're pretty much talking about food, but we still have to be mindful that they have weaponized the food also. So it's best if you can grow your own food without Monsanto seeds, and hopefully the folks on this good platform don't start blanking us out because we're attacking one of their big corporations, maybe even be a sponsor of this, you know? But we're getting attacked from all sides. But it's good to know the history of these things, because it's very important that when we have these arguments and debates, because other folks will try to say that they came up with these ideas and they did this and they did that, as if black people haven't contributed anything to society, when we know we gave them mathematics, astrology, cosmology, right, Brother Black? Gave them the cosmos. We gave everything. Them just about everything. You know, we taught them how to cook. We taught them how to bathe. And this isn't racism or bigotry. This is just historic facts that you can find in their books, you know. But it's important that we know who we are, because they're trying to change that, and they're bringing in a whole new group of people to just push us to the back of the line, because money is being doled out in the tune of billions of dollars. Money's going to the Ukraine. Money's going to the migrants. Where else they sending money? Money's going to Israel. Billions of dollars in three different directions, and we're all getting taxed without, and we can't say nothing about what's happening with our money. Meanwhile, we still have black communities in America that still can't even get clean water and decent housing. There's a problem with that, and we have to be mindful that what goes on outside of these borders is not really our concern. You know, think globally, but act locally. So do what you can where you are. That's very important. So even when it comes down to our food, let's be mindful of what we eat. Everything in moderation. Oreos, sodas, the head of lettuce y'all want to eat, all that in moderation.
Facts, Brother Tag. But before we close out, I'm going to play this real quick on macaroni, and then we'll come back and give our final thoughts and comments and get up out of here. Hold on.
Made from wheat flour and water. Its origins back to ancient Greece. The term macaroni comes from the Greek word for maker, meaning blessed. The pasta became an integral part of the Mediterranean diet and subsequently permeated its way through Greek, Roman, and Arabic cultures. However, the inclusion of cheese into the equation did not come into the existence much later in Europe. First known recipes for a macaroni and pasta type dish was de lasanas, which required layering sheets of pasta with cheese and spices. it can be found in one of the oldest Middle Age cookbooks called The Form of Curry, which was compiled by cooks of England's King Richard II in the 14th century. However, a more recognizable form of the dish originated in Italy, where certain types of pastas and cheese in a casserole were documented all the way back to the 13th century Italian cookbook called the Liber de Cucina. But macaroni and cheese, as we know it, was introduced to the Americas by Thomas Jefferson. But he didn't cook the dish himself. During his tenure as an envoy in France, Thomas Jefferson enjoyed a similar type pasta dish in France, and he commissioned his enslaved black cook by the name of James Hemings to learn how to make it. James Hemings was the older brother of Sally Hemings, who was also the half-brother of Jefferson's deceased wife. In 1784, when Hemings was just 19 years old, he traveled with Jefferson and his daughter to Paris. In Paris, James trained under different French chefs. Over the next 5 years, he became a master of French cooking and got particularly good at cooking macaroni pie. This was a creamy pasta dish that eventually turned into what we know as macaroni and cheese. The recipe involved using whatever cheese he had on hand, layering it in between buttered macaroni mixed with milk. He would then cook it in a Dutch oven, which he placed over a fireplace, and hot coals would be placed over the lid to bake the macaroni and cheese. Even though Hemings' crucial contribution to cooking, and he was famous as a chef, he remained relatively unknown. This was because he was still enslaved under Thomas Jefferson until 1796, and he was one of only two slaves that Jefferson set free, and that was only under the condition that James would teach his younger brother, Peter, to take over in his place as Jefferson's cook of the household. Peter Hemings would then serve the dish at a state dinner in 1802, making.
So that's a little bit background on the history of macaroni and cheese. And for all the Caribbean massive out there, now you know why you call it macaroni pie. There it is. Now you know why you call it macaroni and pie, macaroni pie, and we call it macaroni and cheese. Had to do with the travel. Had to do with the travel of the dish, right? It started in one place. It was enhanced. But even going back to the clip, and shout out to One Mic History. Y'all can follow them on YouTube. They have great videos that you can learn from. But going back even to the fried chicken piece, you know, Black women found a way to create business for themselves. They started selling in on the trains because they had no dining cars. And what did the Urugu do? We'll put them Black women out of business. They won't give us the recipe for that fried chicken. We'll put them out of business and we'll put dining cars on our train. This is why reparation, this is what they were talking about in the clip prior when we discussed reparations, how Black business was destroyed through racism. Through racism. You gave us garbage and we made heaven out of it. Even where we lived, the communities we built, they were undesirable neighborhoods. Nobody wanted them. Undesirable landfills, but we made heaven out of it. And they couldn't take it. And they still can't take it. And this is why the cultural war is being amped up. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our program right here on the BK. On the Brooklyn Bridge. We're going to give my brother Black his final thoughts and comments. Unmute, Black.
Can y'all hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you for that beautiful little piece there, Sister Keisha. We still here. We still doing what we do. As far as, we did talk about some international things. We just maintain and know that this is the scare event. The intel that I've gotten lately says that there will be no nuclear wars. Of course, they're going to be conflagrations all over the place. So just keep your head on a swivel. Tune in to melaninforever.blogspot.com. If you want to friend me, I'm at Elias, E-L-I-A-S, Flavius, F-L-A-V, like Victor, E-U-S. And, just hit me up. You got questions, whatever the case may be. I got some books on sale. I'm constantly posting, and I, you know, tag everybody that's on my Facebook page at least. Love y'all. Love and respect each other. See y'all next week on the bridge. Peace.
Sister Marcia, your final thoughts and comments.
This was a nice trip around food history. Thank you very much. I love to eat, and I echo the sentiments of Brother Tad. I'm not here to bash anyone's meals, but I like the meals that I like, and I don't want to be bashed because I like the meals that I like. One thing I do want to echo in terms of our vote and our citizenship here in America and across the globe, we must be able to hold these political officials accountable. It is our responsibility. Withholding our vote is one thing, but checking them at the door is another thing. And it's a hard skill that we have not learned to do. There's a lot of things in our own lives that we can't hold accountable. And so if we can't do it personally, how are we going to do it publicly? So let's build on our hard skill of responsibility and accountability to not only ourselves, but our community and our nation. And I love this Black side of Third Black Talk and always taking us through a lovely, lovely smell. I smelled all the food, the baked pie, the chicken. Oh man, it all smelled delicious. My friends, may you all have a wonderful weekend. Hey, Sis Keish, I may not be here again for that drive, but I'm going to send you some funds because I appreciate the hard work that you and the Swap Sisters do each and every day. And I don't know how to jump double dutch. Let me just put that out there. Brother Tad, oh, may time flourish for us all, my friends and family. Brother Tad, it's up to you.
You can also follow Sister Marcia on IG, Africans on the Rise. That's Africans on the Rise, Brother Tad.
Yeah, I want to thank everybody for tuning in. You know, definitely got to shout out all of our longtime listeners as well as the new ones. You know, you see us here, we laugh, we joke, we love on each other. You know, it's all in fun, it's all in jest. Hopefully you got a chance to laugh with us. Also, hopefully you learned something that you didn't know before the show started. That's what we're here to do. We're here to educate you and entertain you, all in love, but we definitely want you to get serious about it. We always have to find time to laugh and smile because we're dealing with serious things outside of these parameters, you know. But as Black people who love Black people, we got to find time to enjoy one another, still laugh and still smile, because the enemy wants to keep us in perpetual fear and anxiety. They want us walking around upset, angry, unfocused, not having the ability to love one another and just have fun together, you know. So we're a global community, you know. So I want to thank y'all for tuning in. Hopefully you learned something tonight and you were inspired. It's your turn to go out and inspire others. So y'all stay up, stay blessed, stay true. And remember, no matter how hard things may seem right now, there's always better days ahead. Sister Keisha.
And also you can follow Brother Tad, OG Wisdom Podcast on all your streaming platforms.
Shout out to my dude, C-Gutter.
C-Gutter, C-Gutter, C-Gutter.
Where you at? We got to get Gutter on the show too.
He outside.
Yeah.
Shout out to C Gutter. Definitely check out the OG Wisdom Podcast. And again, family, if you would like to contribute to the coat drive, you can send Sister Keisha Cash App. That's Sister Keisha Cash App. And I will make sure that the coats are purchased and your name is attached to it. Get ready next week. The BK William Mackey History Club. It's going to be fire. Did you know the songs, some of the greatest hits that M2MA produced or have written? Stephanie Mills, What You Gonna Do With My Lovin', Phyllis Hyman, you know How to Love Me, Roberta Flack and Donny Hathaway, Back Together Again, Stephanie Mills and Teddy Pendergrass, Two Hearts, Spinners, Got to Be Love. Here's a sneak peek of what you're gonna get at the lecture with the BK Mackey History Club. And of course, we will post the Zoom link on the Thorough Black Talk Facebook page and Instagram pages so that you can view it live. That's next week, Wednesday, November 15th. Put that on your calendar. Here's what you're going to get a taste of. It's going to be a lot of fun. Here we go, family. So again, shout out to the BK William Mackey History Club. And I'm telling you, family, you're going to want to be in the building for that lecture. It's going down. It's going to be heavy. Don't cut me off, YouTube. I don't own the rights to the music, strictly for educational purposes. Again, thank y'all for joining us on the Brooklyn Bridge. Hope you enjoy the rest of your week. We'll see you black again next week, y'all. We out.
Peace.